Hi, I'm Dr. Justin Koh. I'm Clinic Chief of Medical Dermatology at Stanford Medicine. Today we'll be talking about a general approach to the dermatologic examination. To describe skin lesions, first we have to learn the language of dermatology. It's the common language that we share to describe skin lesions, and this is something we call morphology, which is to describe the general appearance of a skin lesion without any regard to its pathogenesis or its underlying etiology. The first thing that we have to do is we have to identify the primary lesion. We're going to go through and talk about the different primary lesions and provide some clinical examples and images of each. A macule is a non-palpable, less than 1 centimeter lesion, and a petechiae is an example of a macule. If we were to take a macule and increase its size to greater than 1 centimeter, we would have a patch. Vitiligo is a perfect example of a patch. A raised patch, something that you could feel that's raised above the surface of the skin, is called a plaque. Psoriasis is a great example of a plaque. If you were to take a macule and make it palpable, still less than 1 centimeter, we have a papule. And a papule is something that we see typified by a cherry angioma or a wart. In addition, you can have a large papule, something greater than 2 centimeters, which is dome-shaped, and you call that a nodule. An epidermal inclusion cyst is a commonly encountered nodule that we see in the skin. A vesicle is a clear fluid-filled lesion. Herpes is an example of a vesicle. If we have something that looks like a vesicle, but that's instead filled with pus or purulent material, we call that a pustule. And we see pustules in acne and certain kinds of drug eruptions. A large vesicle, greater than 1 centimeter, is called a bulla. And we see bulla in friction or in blistering conditions like bullous pemphigoid. So after we choose the appropriate noun, we have to fill it out with some adjectives. We can talk about the size of a lesion. We can talk about whether or not its borders are clearly defined. In other words, its demarcation.
Well-demarcated lesions, such as we see in erysipelas. Alternatively, lesions can be not well-demarcated, such as in cellulitis.
We can also talk about its color. And in dermatology, there's a lot of conditions which have characteristic colors to them. One example is we see the white of vitiligo, a loss of pigmentation. We can also see a bright red of a drug eruption or a viral exanthem. In addition, purple sometimes connotes a vascular process like Kaposi Sarcoma. We can also see things in the skin that are granulomatous appear brown in color. Yellow sometimes makes us think of xanthomatous lesions or fatty lesions. In addition, we can sometimes see black as being necrotic skin or an eschar. We also see blue as a deep pigmentation, for example, in something called a blue nevus. In addition to the primary morphologies, we oftentimes have secondary or overlying morphologies. Some of these examples include serum, which is dried crust. We can see this in epitigo, or we can see this in acute or subacute eczema. Fissuring is something that we can see, which is a splitting of the skin as a result of hand or foot psoriasis. We can also see lichenification. Lichenification is the thickening of the skin and accentuation of skin lines as a result of chronic rubbing or scratching. Erosions are partial loss of the epidermis, and sometimes we see this as a result of scratching or injuring the skin. Ulcerations are full thickness loss of the epidermis, and sometimes these are frictionally derived or as a result of other primary processes.
It's important to consider the distribution of skin lesions throughout the body as they can help you with the diagnosis. For example, lesions on the extensor surfaces of arms and legs can be seen in psoriasis. Generalized distributions occur in certain drug reactions. We could see a photodistributed rash in connective tissue diseases such as lupus or dermatomyositis. That was a lot of information, so let's quickly review the important parts. Whenever you are attempting to describe a skin problem, remember the primary lesion or morphology, size, demarcation, color, secondary morphology, and distribution.
What you'll need for a skin examination is a well-lit room, a ruler, a magnifying glass, a handheld source of light, and an open and curious mind. We have a patient here today who's going to help us go through some of the important considerations for a dermatologic examination. Hello, sir. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you, doctor.
So using some of what we just discussed, let's practice by describing our patient's rash. So the first thing we want to do is we want to carefully choose our primary lesion. I'm going to choose this area here. When I touch it, I feel that it's raised above the surface of the skin. It's larger than 1 centimeter in size, so the appropriate primary lesion term would be a plaque. After we choose our noun, we want to think about some other descriptive terms that help us fill out some of the adjectives. This is probably a few centimeters in size.
Well demarcated.
Its color is probably dully red, I would describe it as.
In regards to secondary morphology, we see
that it has some crusting, which is dried serum or dried blood. We can also see superficial erosions or areas that the skin has been disrupted. And also we notice some subtle scaling. So taken all together, this is consistent with a diagnosis of psoriasis. This erythematous plaque with overlying scale, excoriation, serum crust, and different lesions and stages of evolution are consistent with this diagnosis on extensor surfaces of the body. One of the other things that we can do sometimes is perform special tests. Sometimes what we do with scaly lesions like this is if we were to peel off some of the scale, we can see if we see an Ostspitz sign, which is signs of focal bleeding from blood vessels that are high up in the surface of the skin. The other thing that we notice about this, stepping back from the primary lesion, is the distribution of the lesion. And looking at the legs, it tends to be on the extensor surfaces of the body. So we see that these plaques are distributed mainly on the legs here, but also when we look above, we see some areas of hyperpigmentation further up on the legs.
Also, given that psoriasis can involve other areas,
one of the areas we want to examine is the scalp. In addition, we want to examine the ear, including the contral bowl and the external auditory meatus, as well as the retroauricular area. Other areas we want to examine include the medial and lateral canthus, the alar groove, the alar rim, and under the chin, the anterior neck. We also want to make sure we examine interdigitally. Always announce what body part you will be examining next and ask permission before doing so. I hope you enjoyed our discussion about an approach to the dermatologic examination, and please visit the Stanford 25 website for more info.
The preceding program is copyrighted by the Board of Trustees of the Leland Stanford Junior University. Please visit us at med.stanford.edu.